This
Okay,
conference
very
will now
good.
be recorded.
It's all yours.
Okay. All right, let's call the meeting to order here, 7:05 p.m. Thank you all for coming. First up, can I get approval of the agenda, please?
Moved.
And a second?
A second.
Very good, thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, all right. Second, approval of meeting minutes, June 15th, 2020, way back when?
Move approval of minutes for June 15th.
Thank you. Can I have a second, please?
Brian, second on our end.
Very good. Okay, we have a second. All approved?
Aye.
Aye.
And the motion carried. Okay, very good. Pete, do we have any visitors this evening?
None at this site, none online that I can see.
Okay, very good. Okay, we'll start with unfinished business, COVID-19 updates, just a verbal report.
Sure, yeah, Joey and I just wanted to take a couple of minutes and tell you where we're at and what we're doing. Joey?
All right, good evening, everyone. Just to start out and give you a few updates on the community center. Some of the most relevant things now that we are done with summer and into kind of school year hours is kind of how we operate. Hours are now extended at the community center. We're now open 6 a.m. till 9 p.m. Monday through Friday. Saturdays are 8 a.m. till 6 p.m. And for the time being, we're staying closed on Sundays. However, starting MEA Sunday, which is October 18th, I believe, then we will open Sundays from 12 to 6. If you've frequented the community center in the past, those hours are a little bit different than they have been. COVID has been a time to kind of reflect and look at, you know, how we operate on some things. And we kind of pulled some past reports and usage of the facility and feel that we're serving the public for the hours that we're open at the time being. You know, when it's nicer out, we have limited hours every year. But we've kind of adjusted those, and then as we go into the winter season, then we kind of ramp up hours a little more that way. So those are hours. One of the other big things with the community center right now, with the start of the school year, is we are housing the Saints Overtime Program, and that is the school age care program for the school district. And that's run through community education. They came to us when the school district announced they'd be in the hybrid model. Community education is tasked with providing care for those families and those kids that need it when their children aren't in school. They're in school 2 days a week, but the 2 days they're not in school, they need space for them. And since the school districts are with their COVID plan, need the school facilities, Saints Overtime, Community Ed didn't have anywhere to go. So with what we have at the community center and what we already have there with the other daycare centers, it just made sense to make something work for them. What it has done is it's taken away some of our meeting space and some of our spaces for other groups, but we work really closely with the school district and thought it would just be their best case scenario if we made it work. So we're giving them 3 to 4 rooms Mondays through Thursdays. Fridays they're at South Elementary. So, because since Friday is a non-in-person school day for the district already. So,
hey, Joey.
A lot more kids in our building, which has been going great. Their staff's doing a great job with all the precautions and things that they've implemented. Other than that, you know, it's pretty standard operating at the community center. Tenants are doing great, and And then so far, so good with the mask mandate and all that comes with operating a facility like that.
Hey, Joey, I got a question. What age group of kids, please? I must have missed that.
So it's school age care. So it's basically kids that would be in everyday school, which is, I think they operate 1 through 6th grade. It could be some kindergartners in there, but I for sure it's 1 through 6th grade.
Okay, thank you.
Kindergarten stays at South. So they do operate a K-4 program. It's just different grades go different places.
Thank you, Laura.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions on community center?
All right. On the public works side, Community Spirit Park is still seeing regular use with school getting cranked up here, mostly school activities. As you guys are aware, the Activities Association modified their schedule for fall here. So Scott is doing some major work out there to make sure that they can practice football. That was something that we had counted on going into spring. That does help us just a little bit if we can get football out of the way going into spring, because otherwise we'd be taxed really heavily with labor trying to get football and baseball somewhat underway in the spring. Public Works has regular hours. We're following the governor's orders. We are seeing additional use at the pavilion and at Gorman Park. The shelters are being well utilized. And Joey's probably mentioned that to a little bit of degree, but a lot of appointments and schedules that are going in there. Playgrounds, parks are all what I would call open, but not heavily utilized right now. We did see quite a bit at the pool this year related to when the pool was open. Now that it's not, there's a little less activity down there. People are just a little more recessed in what they're doing out in the parks and different areas. But nonetheless, it still takes the same amount of maintenance, whether it's 40 people or 200 people. So we're trying to be aware of what's going on. We're getting good feedback from associations as well, talking about their activities for fall here. So overall, it's tolerable, but yet it's quite a challenge. And we're hoping things get better fast.
Amen to that.
That's all I have.
Hey, any questions? All right. Any questions? Okay, hearing none. Let's go to new business, integrated pest management plan.
Sure. We've had several requests just from members that have asked, how do we do things? And so the last couple of months, we wanted to share with you our integrated pest management plan. I'm going to turn this over to Scott to talk about that. Usually what will happen is we present this to the board, let them think about it, give us feedback. And then the following month, we bring it back for approval. So it's kind of on hand of what we're doing. And we certainly are in no hurry to have this adopted. We have run this plan informally for years. We're just finally putting it on paper so everybody can see what the thought is. Hope it generates some questions. And then we can go through that and Scott can answer questions. And I'll turn that over to him.
Good evening. So as you can see, if you've read through it, which I'd assume most of you have, all IPM really is it just kind of tells the public or anyone in that manner of what it is that the city is going to do to combat pests. Pests for this plan are identified as weeds, rodents, insects, and fungus. And probably the key element to the plan is setting the thresholds. The thresholds are just set, the parameter, for instance, in parks, and I'll make this make sense. So 25% of, say, an area, so let's take 4 acres. Let's say a park is 4 acres, and 25% of it is got weeds, let's say. So that means an acre of it has weeds. And the city has a plan to combat that, to say, if, say, that park meets this threshold that we're going to take action to remove the weeds needed, be mechanically or culturally or biologically. The last thing we try to do is we don't want to use chemicals to treat for weeds, but there's many vast opportunities to go different routes than just using chemicals. With along using chemicals, there's organic chemicals work just as well as anything made in a chemist shop. Outside of the turf areas for the thresholds is rodents. Obviously, you don't want any rodents, so that threshold is set rather low. Again, that is also probably most of that's going to be mechanically, with traps, said things like that. There is rodenticides, but there's really, it has to get pretty bad to have to use something like that. As for mosquitoes and insects, we currently do that kind of on a request basis. So for instance, this year we did, what was that, Arts in the Park, Joey, where we sprayed for you guys, or not you guys, but for them, for that group.
Yep.
And I think that was the only group that actually requested it this year.
Right, yeah.
Since I'm new to the whole process, I haven't seen any of those things happen, so they might be a myth as far as I know. But and then last is fungus, which is probably going to be Dutch elm disease. We don't deal with a whole lot of that. But I mean, outside of that, there is tree injections, which we do across the city to try and combat for EAB, and next year we're actually going to inject for Japanese beetles. They really raise havoc on the lindens in this town. So we're going to try to combat with that. But again, I field a lot of questions on chemicals, and that's not our primary source of what we're trying to do, is kill everything with chemicals, because again, there's many different routes that we've used outside of just chemicals. So yeah.
How about question? Do we have a buffer issue?
In some parks, there probably, I would say in McGill, there's buckthorn. Down here at Hallett's, there's buckthorn. There's a couple different ways to mitigate it.
I mean, you hear a lot about that, know when they're using the gold to go into the
house. Right. I don't see it prevalently, but at the same time, I don't really delve into the inside of the parks either.
Yeah, Mark Hansen from the So we've been working with him every fall. He'll have his basketball players as part of the team project come in and start working.
Yeah.
So we don't have any goats yet. So but we'd like to get some in the city budget. If Emily and Shimon would let us have some goats, would you find?
I think they hurt you.
Say, Scott, I got a question for you.
Yep.
Okay, under rodents, and this is a little bit different. I have a possum that likes to come visit me in the fall. He's done that the last 3 years. Does the city loan out traps at all?
We do.
Does Jan?
Yeah, we do.
Okay. Okay, Janet, I think, does that. Okay, very good. Yeah, he's a friendly guy. Looks like he's getting bigger every year, and maybe I should help him find another.
Yeah, that's probably the easiest way to place this, just to displace him.
They take him to Cleveland.
Well, I figured I'd take him across the river, but he can swim pretty good, so. Okay. Thank you.
I wanted to ask about the mosquito stuff. If we're not spraying as often, has anyone heard of, or has the city looked into, there's a product called Mosquito Barrier, and it's a natural product using garlic. If you spray and then have something happen immediately, it does have an odor, but if you spray and then a day later have an activity, the odor is reduced. And anyway, I just, as someone who's tried it, I've used it in my own yard. It works really well and is a natural non-chemical alternative. And so I just thought I'd bring it up since you're talking about pest control. So
We actually use a product in the catch in the basins that has garlic in it. It's mixed with a different chemical as well, but it more is for to kill the larvae. And then whatever survives it, it just sends out an odor. Yeah. So yeah, we have something similar.
Yeah, it's really interesting how it works. It just they don't like the
smell. It's a gas or a smell, actually. Yeah.
Yeah. It's bizarre. So anyway, just thought I'd share.
You know, along that line, is there a product for gnats, do you know, at all? Natural product?
I don't know of one.
Yes, it is funny, but my neighbor, he's a big fogger fan, and he forgot about the wind, and so I think he fogged my house and my yard more than his own. And I don't know. I usually just wear a long sleeve for the gnats. That's my natural barrier, but he prefers a fogger, so I was going to see if I could introduce him to a natural barrier for that.
I don't either. Sarah?
If you've already done the larvicides in the catch basins and we're still having a problem, can we call and have you guys come redo it, or...
No, it doesn't work once. It's more so like we'd usually go out probably early June. You'd probably go out again. In theory, you should probably go out 3 times every month, because there's really no residual with the product outside of probably 14 days. And then once it rains again, it's just going to leach back into the water, and it kind of loses its pizzazz.
Okay.
Outside of that, I haven't received, well, I'm not promoting it, but I haven't received a whole lot of phone calls on mosquitoes, so.
Okay, because we're having a problem up here, and the neighbors were using, I think, mosquito squad or whatever, but I thought you had mentioned that if we called, you guys could come up and dump some more of the larvicide in.
Yeah, we do it. Not as often as you would think we probably do, because so what it is, we take this little, it's like a ladle, and you scoop the water and you count how many larvae are in there, and then out of that is how you figure out what or if you're going to do it, because there is some toxicity to it, so it's not like we promote dumping this stuff in the water.
Yep. Okay.
For this year anyway, in the basins are rather low from what I've gathered from the forester, so.
Yep. Okay.
I just want to say, this is Shannon, by the way, that I really appreciate the city's judicious approach to this. Probably a lot of you heard earlier this summer about what happened in the Fargo area. And I lived in Fargo for many years, and I can tell you from my perspective as a resident, there was or has been many, many years of overspraying, just spraying for mosquitoes all the time. You don't see birds in Fargo like you should. Even my mom lived in Moorhead, which is across the river, for many years. It really affects, I would say, wildlife to the extreme. And so I really appreciate this approach. I was not at all surprised when I saw what happened in Fargo, having lived there for many years.
Good point. Okay, any other questions or comments? All right, very good. I think we'll move to Minnesota Square 2021 Improvement Plan.
Okay, so in your packet tonight, you should have a little form that looks like this. I probably have that again here. Let me get back here to this. And we'll start talking about a little bit of what we've got going on. So Scott was tasked with starting to work on our master plan upgrades for all of our parks. It's been a few years since we last adopted a formal master plan. And so our goal was to start taking parks one by one and developing a strategy that would put us into an area of discussion. So what you're talking about here with Minnesota Square is talks about the park a little bit, If you remember the last study that we did, last master plan, we identified basically where we were, what we did in the past, and what we were going to do in the next couple of years. Here we talk a little bit more about development consideration and needs. With Joey and Scott, we have a little clearer understanding of where we want to go and what we want to do. And so what we're going to try to do is keep one of these in front of you on a regular basis so that we can talk about that individual park in that space. And so today we want to introduce this master plan area to you, which is Minnesota Square, and talk about where we're going and what we're planning to do and make sure that that's the vision that the Parks Board's talked about. So we've talked about a variety of different things, and it's a lot more narrative here so that you guys can draw the picture. And as we develop some plans, we will pull together for you the layout and have discussion on those items. It does talk about funding to a degree. So here you talk about potential development cost of what it takes to do something as far as the priorities go. We identify plaza construction. We talk about sidewalk here, parking lot and sidewalk improvements, and those, where they would go and what would happen on those, depending on the funding that comes available, of course. Signage is a regular thing, and then activities that go on in that park. And some you're going to see as a community park are going to have larger and numerous opportunities. When you get to a neighborhood park, it's probably going to be a lot less detail, but will be more directed towards a certain activity. And as you can see here, we've got a variety of different options. Not all of these would be very popular with everybody that attends there, but we wanted to throw those out for you and have some discussion. We do have some slides in here that talk about a variety of different things. So here is our plaza concept. As we talked about with our plaza concept, to put in something that we have outlined right in this photograph here is going to be right around $400,000. And as you know, we have $140,000 this year to spend. So let's give you an idea of what we're thinking about as far as how these activities look. What you're seeing in the box square, if you can see that, is about $140,000 right there. Believe it or not, we can get the sidewalk started going towards the landing for Veterans Memorial, which goes up towards that direction. The restrooms are over here. If you know where the pavilion, this is where the band plays going out. Okay, we're right towards where it says new pavilion. These area here are going to be vendor areas, and they'll serve a variety of different activities there. They are sized for food. They are sized for additional tents, meaning that if Rock Band was going on, this area could support probably two tented vendors. You could have another one right in the area between these two. So this whole area here would be about five vendors. Here'd be another five vendors. You'd have a nice thorough walkway through here. You could have food service in these areas. As you can see here, we got little benches on the outside of planters. So we're going to have planters inside here that would have water to them and electricity to them. And then this would be your entrance coming off of College Avenue. And so if you remember our conversation just in this area for this year, we want to make a tie with downtown. We've got a nice little tunnel through there, and our trees are overgrown just about enough now that we can shape that. So it didn't help us a lot without a really nice plan going through there. This would also be one of your accesses to the pavilion. So when I have Rock Band trucks that come the day before Rock Band starts, these bollards will be moved. They're movable. They would drive in here with their trucks following my arrow. They'd come up here, unload their stuff, head back out, park their truck down the road, and then these activities would go on. It's not meant to have cars and trucks parked up there or moving during the event, but for deliveries before and after. We also can make a city vehicle available to them, whether it's a tool cat or a golf cart or whatever we have in the future that can navigate some of these. This area here is about 60 feet, as Scott's identified here, total width. Now, that's a lot of concrete. That'd be a really nice landing area. We're starting to see a lot of people come here for lunch on a daily basis. And again, we'll have water, sewer, and new electricity in this area to support that. Phase two of the project would then, whoops, sorry, would roughly go in here and make that tie in with what's going on up at the pavilion. And that area too would be roughly $140,000. We'd be in the 280 range. That's if we can do some of the utility work, electrical work ourselves in order to save that. The concrete would be rather expensive, but it's quite an area in there to develop that park line. How about questions as we start?
Would this solve the electrical issue that's come up in the past many times?
It will.
Brian's
question was, will this solve the electrical questions for the vendors that were back here? We are proposing to change some of that electric. We had worked with the ambassadors and with the chamber and with Rock Band. And they were not willing at this time to help us with that project. So the answer, probably the quickest answer, is no. If nothing changes as far as the location of where they want to have vendors, they're still going to have problems because they've got several units plugged into one outlet. But over here, these would all be, you could easily move three or four of those vendors here and then your problems are gone. It would help that problem. But again, they rent the park or basically use the park to their advantage. And if they see something that they like to operate, we don't discourage that. But we do want to develop this because as a walkway through St. Peter in two blocks, you now are at the food co-op, you're at the Redmond, you're downtown, at any of the restaurants. So
I know we talked about it before, and I think that's important because it opens it up so it looks like part of the city or whatever. Right now, if you come down Third Street, you can barely see the pavilion or what's
Right.
There's no clear.
So in the future, as you guys remember, we have applied for grant funding for through the DNR here, and we'll still work on individual improvements with sidewalk. Any funds that we'd have, we'd like to put these linking, what I call meeting blocks. So these would be a walkway that's continued. So we could easily do one portion if funding became available, or if somebody wanted to donate something there, a group or a family that is interested in that. And we'll have some other design criteria and things that come forward to the next board, but this is really a good first view of some of the concepts going on. And then if you guys remember our Damon Farber study, this again is with the new pavilion in here. And we're talking about how we'd have people come in here to the plaza. So you could have food or merchandise on either side, mostly those tents that we talked about. And then this area here would be reserved for concert goers. So the ideal situation, just like Brian requested, was can we get that food truck or new electrical back in this area so that we can serve a larger area for the concert up front here? And during Rock Band, you'll see people sitting over here in this area, which is still fine, but we'd like to concentrate them between these two walkways and bring them back just a hair. As you know, right now, they kind of sit up here, right around this circle. If you know where the flagpole is, it's right there in front. And then we have outer areas where they have additional merchandising and different things. In the future, as you guys are aware, Tot Lot's going to be in this little slice of the pie. 5 to 12-year-old playground in this little area. That ballpark has now been removed, and we'll be looking at a parking lot. And I don't know if we've got that picture. Okay. But in the future, we'll be looking at a parking lot and concert staging area off of Elm Street, which would help with ADA access for some of our citizens and get them right up to the pavilion. So we see a bright future for that area. And budget-wise, we'll be working on that little by little to get things going. As I mentioned before, sidewalk, again, where our goal is to have several landings. One here by where the playground is now, another one here by the Vets Memorial. And I call these just linking areas of sidewalk. So our ideal is we want to create that foot traffic around the park. And so whether you're at a tot lot or where you're at, you've got a safe way to get to each of the areas. With our core being developed already here at the pavilion, we think that we'll see a lot more foot traffic, a lot more people in there trying to make things happen and using that facility. Again, parking lot in some of those areas, roughly $50,000 off of Elm Street. That does seem pretty possible as far as a working document. Signage we've already accomplished. There is a need to improve sand volleyball courts, so we'll be working with the rec department. Currently, you have one park sand volleyball cart right here, and another park right there. And so in the future, we'll have to make a determination on what these things are going to be. Tennis courts, right now they're concrete, whether they're sand volleyball or what we turn those into from that point. Lighting, again, for the sand volleyball, should that be a key issue, we'll be working with the association that they have there to fundraise a little bit for that. Kind of following the model of all of our park development, what's key here is who brings what to the table. I know the ambassadors, the chamber, including the 4th of July, I think next year, if COVID does get controlled a little better, you're going to see a lot of people want to get out to parks. And we have received so many positive comments from citizens in town about how Minnesota Square looks. There's quite a few little groups of coffee coming down and having coffee at the square now in morning. So we'll touch base with them again and see what we can do and look for different funding areas. Lastly, I want to talk about two things that we're mentioning here. That is playground upgrades. Okay, we're going to be doing some pricing of those, trying to get some quotes on what's going on. We do have an older playground that's up in this northwest corner. And so the idea behind this is that is all going to stay in place until this area to the southeast is built. So even if we do it one little bit at a time, in conjunction with sidewalks, we're going to have Damon Farber lay that out for us. So what I call this slice of the pie adjacent to the bathroom, we're going to start working on that a little bit as far as laying that out and then looking for different funding opportunities. Whether it be grants or cost sharing, we'll try to maneuver that a little bit. This is one of the areas at Minnesota Square that we had targeted for all-inclusive ADA parks. And so our number may be a little low based on how we had talked about putting a rubberized surface in here and some other activities. And so we'll try to update those numbers. I think these initial numbers might be just a hair low for us. And then we also threw in a splash pad, which we talked about putting over in this area, or roughly in this area where we have some water and sewer opportunities. And I'm not talking a splash pad that would compete with our swimming pool. What I'm talking about is a smaller area that you could have water coming up through some nice little rain areas or umbrellas or whatever the case would be. But it'd be on a smaller scale, so if people are at the park, they could rinse off or cool down. As I mentioned there, that's just been an idea. And my goal in talking about this with you guys is I want your feedback. And if you like the new formula, the new presentation that we've developed, and any comments on priorities and any opportunities for fundraising. So I guess I would open it up for questions now and take some feedback.
Go ahead. We talked about diagonal parking. Was that still in the works or?
That was. Yep, we talked about diagonal parking here. If you look in the map here, that would be along Elm Street, yes. And so right now, Scott's still evaluating. This is our priority area. Start this way and go around the corner. And we talked about it here. We have a MSA street on College Avenue, which means that we are getting funds for replacement of that surface and parking and different activities. So we can do that first to a degree, and that would be this area. So what we do is we evaluate this asphalt surface every couple of years to see what condition it's in and whether we need to put resources in there and use MSA funds to develop that. This would certainly help with the Vets Memorial parking. Okay, no doubt about that. That's something that we really would like to see. I think this would too, except for if we do move the parking or the playgrounds, this is far away from that. So it's possible that this could be our first area and do it in piecemeal, and this could be our second area. Because this will get used first once the playgrounds are implemented. Yeah, and we'll have our parking lot in here too. So if we have kids with handicap issues, they can get on a sidewalk and get wheeled right over here.
So yes, yeah. Street is a little narrow on that side. Fourth,
yeah,
right.
So
yeah, I know what's out there too. Some of the congestion along there when you come driving through there with the event going on also. So I guess they're all kind of important.
Yeah, we'll add the parking lot and sidewalk. We'll just put parking issues here and start working on that and address that.
Comment about the playground location. Is there going to be, I haven't been down there to really look, but is there going to be sufficient shade in that area?
We do have several trees in that area.
That part?
We have to plant some. Yeah. Right, we'd have to do some planting in that area, but there are a few trees in that area.
Mm-hmm. I have a follow-up question just about the playground area. Thinking of the proximity to the sidewalk, will there be a fence or something to kind of, I'm just thinking when my kids were toddlers, they would have loved to try to get on the sidewalk and make a getaway.
Yeah, we'd have to look at that. So we have the little kids in here. So the five and under are in the tot lot area, and there would be a sidewalk between these. Similar to what you saw at the pool.
Yep.
You have a playground with a sidewalk or a containment area, whether there's trees planted here or whatever there is here. This would be your 5 to 12. Doesn't mean that the little guys won't get over here and take off, but there'll either be some kind of barrier, whether it be rocks or whatever. Fence, I don't know about a fence. It probably wouldn't hurt to have a fence in here. You know, you'd put a decorative fence in there and just have a barrier so they can't get past it. But they'd have to be able to get around that, or maybe a gate here that they could walk through that playground.
Thanks. I think having the tot lot sort of more interior helps a lot.
Yeah.
Sure.
A fence might be good if you have the concert staging, if cars are coming in and out of that area. That can, I mean, it does seem somewhat close to those playgrounds, so maybe a small fence would be a good idea to separate those two.
Sure, you'd be talking more along this line here then?
No, I thought you were for the concert staging. Isn't that where cars will be coming in for?
If when cars come in during a concert, the trucks and vans that deliver to the pavilion that have to drive in here for the musicians would come in here off of College.
Yep.
The vendors would be coming in here if they still stay back in this area. But that's part of what we're trying to control is not having vendors driving all over.
And cords running all over.
Right. Cords is right.
Yep.
Well, one of the reasons we talked about moving the playground was because they wanted it Remember, I thought it should be closer to the washer.
Right.
And it was cross-rimmed, and they built a washer over on the other side, or at least as I understood it at the time. So that's why I kind of leaned towards this, because I remember that issue.
Right.
It came way across.
How about other points of discussion?
Pete, it's just a small one here. I really like the exposed aggregate concrete pad. That looks sharp, but I'm just curious, what's the cost differential between that and regular concrete?
As far as we know, it would be minimal. I know it does cost additional, and our goal yep. would be to identify areas that would be used for vendors to come in. So during the week, you'd see tables possibly set up in that area. People that are coordinating through the rec department, they'd have to make an appointment. It wouldn't be uncommon during noon to see a sandwich truck come in there. It wouldn't be uncommon during Rock Band to see somebody selling beads and t-shirts and different things in those areas. But yet you'd have a nice walkway to maneuver around.
Yeah, no, it'll look sharp. I'm just curious if it was a higher cost, a much higher, but no, exposed ag looks really sharp. So that's
yeah, it is. Touch. It is a little extra, but I guess we're using it as a deciding factor of where do we do certain functions.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions, comments for Pete?
Well, if you do have comments or questions, please let Angie know.
I think for myself, a big issue is going to be where to start.
Mm-hmm.
Because that would determine public support, I think, for any other improvements. So the idea of connecting the park with Third Street might be the place to start.
If right, you're talking this area here, Mike?
Say again?
You're talking in the blue area?
Yep.
Here? Okay.
That would be, if we could find the funding, that would be a great way to introduce the public.
Right, and that is, Mike, one of the areas that we talked about starting in based on previous conversations with the board and then what we tried to fund this year for the 2021 budget.
Right. So what could we do to show a commitment to that as a within our budget currently?
Right. I think the things we'd have to do first would be put the electrical in and then work with Damon Farber and Bolton and Mink, our engineering firm, to lay that out and get some details so that we can start looking at a project and get some cost identified.
Okay. So our commitment out of the current budget would be for planning. Am I hearing you correctly?
Correct.
Okay.
Well, feel free to call Scott or myself or email Angie. And we'll take input and feedback and refine our plan and start bringing some numbers back. Also looking at, we've got feedback from you guys on horizontal parking. We'll add that to the master plan here and identify some potential cost and a priority for that. And then anything else here that you see that needs to be updated, please let us know.
And you're gonna start with the horizontal parking by the Vets Memorial, right? That would be our first place.
That certainly can. I guess I'd love your feedback. If you guys think that's the place we should start first, we would price that out. So that would be this area here. And then what we would do is go across and look at something either here or here. Most likely here is where we'd probably get the biggest bang for our buck.
Yeah.
As an option. So we can lay out some costs for this. What we're trying to do is tie it to the street project. So where this becomes cost effective is using state aid funding to relay that street and parking over here, meaning that we wouldn't have out of pocket expenses. We would be using a cash and money that we have available to us. It's in our account because this road here is a state aid road. Yeah, that's just how we set it up when we linked it. Yeah, it's a MSA road is what it is. I think I misspoke there. It's a MSA road.
Say, Pete, are you looking for any kind of general consensus? I don't know if we do a motion until we get costs back, but are you looking for any of that tonight?
How about if we update this and we bring this back in October with our changes and identify those issues, and then we would move have an action item on there that says we're looking for adoption of the Minnesota Square Plan at that time.
Okay, that makes sense. Yeah, if you could have a little schedule of events, all of that, that'd be great.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, next item. Thank you, Pete. Reports, chair's report. Really don't have anything other than it was a nice weekend, a lot of activity in town. I did see Minnesota Square Park had a nice gathering this weekend. I'm sure everybody was socially distanced, but it was a nice group there. And hearing a lot of positive comments about Minnesota Square as well. So good job.
Great.
Any other reports? Okay, we can move on to Department of Rec. Joey.
All right, so since we haven't met in a few months, you'll see in your packet there's three activity reports in there, June, July, and August. I'm not going to go through all of those tonight with you. However, if you did notice anything in the packet that kind of stood out from the reports or have questions anytime, please contact me. Happy to answer any questions. And what I want to do is just to jump into our summer recap since we have those 3 months in your packet. So this summer, just like everyone else's summer, was really different for the rec department. And we kind of identified it early on that in order to be to give the community opportunities, we're going to have to do things very different and out of our comfort zone, out of what we've done in the past. We were excited to learn a few things about ourselves. We started our camp program, which is usually a pretty large in-person camp program that we did all virtually for the summer. And we were very surprised on how well that went over. I think it was a combination of the school year saw a couple months of virtual and people weren't quite burnt out yet on everything virtual. And we had really positive response. We had a lot of signups. We had a lot of families tell us that they just loved it and would like us to keep it around for years to come. So that was really nice to hear. The biggest thing that I saw is how our staff from the first week to the last week of our virtual camps really did a wonderful job of growing and making these camps into something pretty special for the kids. So that was nice to see. We had a lot of interaction for the older kids that they were still allowed to interact with staff and each other. And we also got a lot of feedback that, you know, these kids would, from parents just told us the kids would just like to get together with groups of other kids and kind of socialize together. Cause that's what a lot of families have been missing out on during this pandemic. So Those are kind of the highlights for youth programming. Once we hit July, we started doing a lot more in-person programming with safety measures, which was nice to have a combination of in-person and virtual. But we had to limit numbers and things like that. So we didn't have your big, huge T-ball programs and things like that. We did do T-ball late in the summer, but it was at reduced capacity, went over fairly well and kind of filled those up. So it was good to get some of those in late summer. And, you know, one of the biggest areas that we were, our department was hurting on is our senior programming. We have a lot of senior programming normally, and that's one area that we just couldn't safely do in person, just through the Minnesota Department of Health, you know, and their guidelines really, you know, being very careful with that population. So we had to pivot pretty quickly. We wrote a lot of grants, and finally at the end of the summer, we secured a pretty cool grant. You're gonna see these isolation kits come out that are different themed, and we're gonna do a big campaign on that this fall and see a lot more ramped up on that. So, but that's kind of the summer. We tried to promote as much activity outside. We didn't do indoor programming. Made the best of getting people outside and door and getting them to enjoy our mini parks we have in the community and do some cool things that way. All right, from there then, I wanted to jump into a pool report, and I apologize for not noticing that wasn't in the packet earlier, but you should have got an email today late in the afternoon with some pool statistics. And I just want to touch on a few highlights here for you. And we were closed the whole month of June and the first couple days of July. So in a normal year, we have about 75 or so days that were open. This year we were open 37 days. So much different, yeah, a little less than half of what we would have been. If you recall, at the end of the summer, we did shut down the pool 2 weeks early. Due to staff member testing positive, and that staff member was in close contact with some of our other lifeguard staff. None of that staff did end up testing positive, but it was a safety measure. And with the timing of the summer, with 2 weeks left to go, it was in our best interest just to make sure to keep our community safe and shut down early. Otherwise, you'll notice we didn't do any pool passes this year. We did a reservation system, so that was much different. So revenues are way down from where they were. And the biggest reason for that is we were not able to do as many swim lessons as we have in the past. That's where we saw the biggest drop in our revenue. I think that's on page 3. But with that, you know, we still served about 85 kids in swim lessons that wouldn't have got served this summer if they didn't. And part of that was some families just weren't comfortable doing that yet, even with safety precautions in place. And on top of that, we had a few restrictions on our time and when we were able to do things, just with the different cleaning measures and protocol we had to put in place after each open swim, each swim lesson. We were disinfecting locker rooms, pool deck, all that good stuff. So I'll let you look that over again. If there's any questions on the pool, I'm happy to answer any questions for you. Now, this isn't, in a normal year, the pool is not a moneymaker. It is something that the city's identified as a amenity for the community that we think is very important. It really brings our community together, and it really, you know, when if you go down to a pool, you kind of see what our community really looks like down at the pool. I think we have all our different, we have great diversity down there, all our different people from different walks of life, and it really is a good indication of our community and during most summers. So, and we think it's very important. It's important to teach kids how to swim, and we're just grateful that City Council has made it important to keep our pool going. And we hope to keep it going for a long time. Our maintenance staff does a great job making sure mechanically things are operating efficiently, making sure it's clean, and really is a good representation, even though it's a 50, 60-year-old pool, that it's, you know, it's held up this long and is in a relatively good shape. So any questions on pool report? Okay, well then I will just jump into a little bit of fall programming that we can even touch on more next month. But just a few things to touch on. Our fall brochure was out at the beginning of September, again with community education. A lot of the same type of things that we did in summer, where there's in-person programming and virtual programming, not as much virtual programming. The virtual programming is kind of around special events like holidays, MEA break, and some of those things, and has had great response so far. We did move a couple of our normally large fall programs into different seasons. So normally we have a large youth volleyball program and a youth flag football program. You know, when the state high school league moved those to the spring, a lot of our relationships that we have. So we're in the Valley Volleyball League. That league decided to vote volleyball to move to spring as well. So that was kind of out of our own hands. So we weren't doing that. We have some local groups renting gym space, doing some things volleyball related for the community, but we'll see that in the spring. Flag football was one that we thought about doing, a skills and drills and not doing games and things like that, like normal. But all of our flag football coaches are Gustavus football players, and they were still up in the air when we had to plan things. So we just decided to move that to the spring as well. But there is a group running some youth flag football up at Community Spirit Park right now as well. So still an option in the community, but you'll see our large program in springtime with that. Some other fall stuff, we have Active Aging Week coming October 5th through the 9th. There's activities every day that it's gonna be a pretty cool week and a lot of interest in that already. We are gonna do a senior expo that week. It's gonna be much smaller scale, where people need to reserve their time to come in, as well as the vendors are pre-registering as well. Totally free senior expo, but there'll be limits on how many people are in the facility at one time for that. But all that can be found in our activity brochure, and a lot going on between the rec department and community education. So a lot of exciting things, and now we're already transitioning to plan out winter and all that comes with that as well. Even though it's not going to snow this year, Pete told me before the meeting, actually.
You're just trying to get me in trouble, Joey.
Yep. All right. Any questions? All right. Thank you.
No questions. I was just going to say, Joey, you're doing a great job. It just sounds really, it's really great, all the programming that you were able to do, even with the restrictions. So you and your team did a great job this summer. So, yay.
Well, thank you. And that's all credit to our team. They're working hard, you know, and at times they get frustrated because they plan something and then have to replan it and replan it and replan it again, which I know a lot of you are having to do too. But it's nice to hear those comments, and I'll let them know that, you know, they are making a difference in some of the things they're doing. And it's important to have options and still have opportunities for our community to participate in.
Al, I'll just go right into the Public Works report. Is that okay? I'll take that as a yes. So far, we haven't done much work on Levy Park this summer and fall. So we're going to be kicking that back up here and trying to get a plan for 2021. We do have a rendered plan that hasn't changed too much, so we'll be working with the core group on those activities and bringing back some cost estimates once we receive those. So Levy Park is still active. I'm assuming that they're going to come back to the Parks Board and ask for a park name change, which is what you guys do. You approve or disapprove or make a recommendation to the city council. And they've done a lot of work on it. They've got some nice drawings. We'll spend a little more time with that in the near future. The other issue is Thompson Dog Park. I just wanted to bring you up to speed. I will put a report in the October Parks Board minutes for you guys to review. But basically, we built what is out there right now for about $75,000. Out of that $75,000, the River Valley Dog Park Association raised $32,000. So they roughly raised about 42% of the capital that it took to get that dog park built, which is a nice fund. Out of the remaining $43,000, the city came up with, we had $15,000. Our original goal was to spend $15,000 in cash and in-kind services to make that dog park happen. With the activities that we did to get accomplished, there was about a $28,000 shortfall. We made up for that by working, by not doing the ag line project at Community Spirit Park that was produced in the 2020 budget. And the reason that that park, those funds were used was because the school had a financial conflict with their half of that activity. So their focus was $200,000 on a park restroom, concession stand and ticket booth was where they wanted to spend their money. And so we took our share of the improvements and we put it towards the dog park and made good use of it. In the future, we are working on phase two improvements for 2021, 22, whatever year that would come about. And you can kind of see the items here related to the priority. So it's item and priority are basically the same thing. And as you can see, the areas in red were activities that we completed in phase one of that dog park installation. We had some trees and received donations for some dog waste stations and some refill bags. And so as those came across, we were glad to take those. The entrances, Scott was nice enough to put turf in there that we received from Gustavus. And so we operate the dog park just like we do tennis, baseball, softball associations. We participate with that association or group to raise funds. We try to keep it fairly simple. If you bring the resources to the table, we are glad to try to help install it. So going forward, now that the initial park has been built, we go back to the association model and we'll be working with their group to identify different activities as we raise funds. I think Scott had mentioned today to me that they'd raised about $5,000 for phase two. I'm not sure that's in the bank yet, but I'm sure that they've done some different activities. Their number one focus is shade with concrete. So you'll be looking at next spring, April or May, possibly a nice little shade structure going up there with some concrete underneath it. And then we would have that on both sides of the fence. So there'd be possibly two structures in there, one at a time, and we'd go from there. We do have scheduled about a little over $50,000 in improvements if the funding comes in for it. So you can see quite a facility over there. You certainly are seeing the numbers as far as how many people are visiting that site right now. We're really happy with the addition that it brings to the community and the number of people it's bringing together. And I would be glad to answer any questions on the dog park if you have any. I think one of the other things to mention here was there was an Eagle Scout that donated picnic tables, some wood benches, some boxes, and agility ramps over there. And that was very nice of him to come forward. And I know that the River Valley Dog Park Association paid him for that, for the wood, or bought the materials and he built it. So that model seems to be working well with what we have going on there. And that's all I have, Al, unless there's questions that Scott or Joey or I can answer.
Not seeing any questions. Want to thank you, Pete. Scott, thank you. Joey, thank you.
I have a comment.
Oh, yes, sir. Mike.
Yeah. I think public recognition ought to be given to your crew that worked on Stone Sway Park.
Sure.
Tremendous improvement there on the south side. especially around the playground.
Great, I'll let it know.
The entry point on the northwest side of Gorman Park is vastly improved.
Yeah.
Cleaning up that, those trees there.
Yeah, thank you. That's a lot of our park staff working with our forester, who's a part of the park section there. So we've incorporated those guys together. It's been a little bit of a challenge for them to grow into some new roles, but they have really worked hard to improve the looks down there. And we have seen and heard so many comments that are positive about how they've taken care of the trees.
Yep.
And the downtown flowers. That's their group too that do that. And we appreciate all the positive comments and feedback.
Yeah, Pete, I'll echo that. I've heard a lot of positive comments from the community, and just I know how hard your team is working, and especially in the summer with all the upkeep and all the trees and things. So we really appreciate all of that your team is doing.
Thank you. I have nothing else for you guys tonight, Al.
Okay, very good. I think we're done with our comments. Again, appreciate all of you guys, everyone showing up tonight. We finally had a quorum here, so that worked out good. I'd like a motion to adjourn, please.
So moved.
And a second.
Emily will second.
Awesome. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Great. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Pete.
Yep. Thanks, guys. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Bye.